Okay. So then we have water reabsorption in the distal convoluted tubules and the collecting ducts. So just for a real quick review for you here, remember that if you're going to reabsorb water in the distal convoluted tubules or collecting ducts, it requires ADH. Okay, got to have antidiuretic hormone. Remember, it's stored in the posterior pituitary. It's synthesized by the hypothalamus. So if you have low blood pressure or you have a high sodium level in the plasma, the hypothalamus will detect this and signals the posterior pituitary to release ADH, and it goes out into the plasma. So then ADH binds to the receptor. Note where we are. We're on the basolateral membrane of the distal convoluted tubule or the collecting duct. So when ADH binds to the receptor, that activates your G protein. Alpha subunit slides over. You activate adenylate cyclase, which is that red little critter. Once adenylate cyclase has been activated, ATP gets converted over to cyclic AMP. Cyclic AMP, we know, activates protein kinase A. Protein kinase always phosphorylates. So in this case, it's going to end up causing the insertion of the aquaporin. Remember that water requires an aquaporin to be moved. So the water then, out here in the lumen of the distal convoluted tubule of the collecting ducts, can then move through the aquaporin. We can reabsorb it across the apical membrane, across the basolateral membrane, and now into the plasma. Okay? Don't worry about the aquaporin numbers, right? There's aquaporin 2, aquaporin 3. We don't care about the number, but you need to understand what an aquaporin is and how it gets inserted into the membrane. And the only way the aquaporin is going to get inserted into the membrane is if you have ADH present. If there's no ADH, this cell is impermeable to water and you won't be able to reabsorb it.